إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا. من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له. وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله. أما بعد، فإن أصدق الحديث كتاب الله وخير الهدى هدى محمد صلى الله عليه وآله وسلم، وشر الأمور محدثاتها وكل محدثة بدعة وكل بدعة ضلالة وكل ضلالة في النار. After praising Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, we continue our journey with al-ashrat al-mubashara, the 10 individuals who have been promised paradise upon the blessed tongue of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. The fourth khalifa is our discussion today. And in a prelude, before we discuss his life and his faba'il and his munaqib, his virtues and his rank and his prestige and dignity that belongs to him, it is important to highlight the difference between, many times we touched upon, between Ahlul Sunnati wa Ahlul Shia, the people of Sunnah and the people who are splinter group, a group that begins to go against the teachings and the belief of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Because unfortunately many times we find people making a statement that we are all Muslims and there should be no distinction. Yes, we are Muslims, but there are different forms of categories and types of Muslims that we find, that a certain type of loyalty and disloyalty is placed in this Muslim Ummah. That there are those individuals who fall generally under the banner of Ahlul Sunnati wal Jama'ah. Whatever the titles of these various groups that we may be surrounded by, in general, ulama, they conclude that the people who follow various madahib, various schools of thoughts, are classified under the general banner of being people of Sunnah. The people who go against the Sunnah are those individuals who preach against it, begin to teach people a belief which is corrupt, a belief which is far away from the teachings of the Quran and the Sunnah, وَيَدْعُونَ إِلَيْهِ and begin to call people towards that, and begin to go against the mainstream jama'ah of the Muslim Ummah. They are the ones who are to be classified as those who are left the fold of Ahlul Sunnati wal Jama'ah. Thus we find that extreme Shia that we find, مِنَ الرُّوَافِرْ وَإِثْنَ عَشَّرِيَا, the 12 Imams who believe in that, an extreme Shia that we find, the Ghulat Shia, which in essence, the land of Iran that we find is based upon the extreme views. The Ayatollahs that they have, even the massive individuals don't know what their creed or their belief is. But the mainstream leaders are individuals who know what their creed is, and they begin to teach people that creed. And at times they begin to unfortunately penetrate into our minds, or trying to say they are people who show love and devotion to the family members of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And this could be slightly true. It's like tarnish on people of Sunnah, that we don't show that ahmiyyah, we don't show that emotional feeling that should be displayed towards the family members of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And as we find it in books of Aqa'id, many of the ulama would conclude by talking about love of Ahlul Bayt, love of the family of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, love towards his companions as well. It's all a symbol of Ahlul Sunnati wal Jama'ah. Thus Imam Malik, he highlighted, you want to see who is a person of the Sunnah, who is a Sunni, is a person who loves the companions, who loves his family household. That is a symbolic gesture to begin to recognize people of the Sunnah, that they preach and they speak well throughout the lives of the companions and make excuses for those things that took place amongst themselves in their lives. And thus we find that love towards the family members is incumbent upon this Muslim Ummah, incumbent upon us people of the Sunnah, to remind ourselves. As we find in various ahadith that we find, وَذَكِّرُكُمُ اللَّهِ, I remind you by the right which belongs to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala regarding my family members, that show goodness towards my family members. Likewise the Quran mentions, لَا أَسْأَلُكُمْ عَلِيْهِ أَجْرًا إِلَّا الْمَوَدَّةَ فِي الْقُرْبَةِ, I ask you for no love or no reward to recompense to be given to me, except for to show love and devotion to qurba. And as many of the ulama mufassirun have literally taken that qurba, the close individual, means the family members, the relatives of the Prophet alayhi salatu salam. A person should show immense love and devotion towards these individuals, the family members of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Now we find the ayat inside Surah Al Imran, some verse 71 or so that we find. Qul ta'ala nad'u, come call upon us, or call, bring forth our children, our sons and our daughters, your sons and your daughters, and our wives and your wives. Bring these people, these family members out. And let us make this what's known as Ayatul Mubahala, the ayah of challenging, that the curse of Allah be upon those individuals with the liars. So call our children, your children. Ulama tafsir that they mentioned that the Prophet alayhi wa sallam, he called out Fatima, wa Ali, wa al-Hassan, wa al-Husayn, Allahumma ha'ulai ahli. And then he said that these are my family members. So according to this verse inside the Quran, he said, bring up your children. He brought up his own daughter Fatima, told her to come out, brought up her husband Ali, brought out his two grandchildren, and said, Allahumma ha'ulai ahli. These are my family members, that if I'm wrong in any manner, then let the curse and the anger of Allah and I come upon my family members. And as we find that Ali ibn Abi Talib, that we find, was a cousin of the Prophet alayhi salam, Abu Talib being his uncle. And as we find that ulama mentioned that there's certain uncles of his that believed and certain of them who disbelieved. And the love, the devotion that he had towards Abu Talib, the respect that he had towards him, because after becoming an orphan, then his grandfather Abdul Muttalib passing away, then he was placed underneath the care of his uncle Abu Talib. And I'm sure that most of us are familiar with the seerah of how he spent most of his life defending his son. This is an individual, and there's no doubt about this, an individual who was a disbeliever. وَمَاتَ عَلَى ذَلِكَ, and died upon that. And the Prophet ﷺ was so taken aback by his death that we find that he asked Allah ﷻ to pray forgiveness for his family members, or pray forgiveness for his uncle. And until Allah ﷻ rebuked him regarding that. And thus we find that love and that devotion, ulama mentioned, al-hubbul tabi'i, a natural love that we find that some of us we fail to understand. That's what Imam Qadi al-Iyadi mentioned, al-hubbu anwa'un. Love has various formats that we find. Some of us we just make it black and white. For a person to love their father, their mother, their son, their daughter, their family members, their land, their country, their people, it's all part of love. It's not a love which is tainted with kufr, disbelief, hubbu tabi'i, a natural love that we find every individual has. In kanu min al-Muslimin or min ghayri al-Muslimin, whether these people are Muslims or non-Muslims, person will have that natural love and affiliation towards their family members. Islam does not prevent one from that. Hatta you find some narrations or some wording that you find hubbul watani min al-Iman, to love one's people, one's nation from Iman. Even the statement is min al-Mawdu'at, as Imam al-Jawzi highlights in his book Kitab al-Mawdu'at. But the meaning has some essence, that a person loves their family members, loves their country, loves their taqafa, loves their culture, loves their people, as long as they don't clash with Islam. So the Prophet alayhi sallam, he had this natural love, because he defended him more at that time than some of the Muslims around him. Defended, risked their life, risked their wealth, risked their honor, the dignity that we find. He risked it all to protect the Prophet alayhi sallam. And as we find, when he came to him on his deathbed, he said to him, say this one word, وَحَاجُبِكَ عِنْدَ اللَّهِ سُبْحَانَهُ وَتَعَالَى, say this kalima, and I will dispute, I will argue with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala day of judgment. Just say this one word, قُلْ لَا إِلَهَ إِلَّا اللَّهِ, say لَا إِلَهَ إِلَّا اللَّهِ, say this, and I will argue in front of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But we find that Abu Talib at that moment in time, the influence of the people around him, are you going to give up the way of your forefathers Abdul Muttalib? Many people even today that we find sunnat al-layl al-ard, the reason why they don't enter into Islam, amongst the reasons that we find is al-kibr, is arrogance that we find, and also that we find is a rejection of not wanting to go against their family members, against their people, against their culture, against their land. Don't want to be outcast. It's a common practice, a common feeling many people that they have. So Abu Talib at that moment in time, he decided to sway, hold fast to the belief of the forefathers. And thus we find that he died upon that.
لقنوا موتاكم بلا إله إلا الله. Remind your dying individuals بلا إله إلا الله. With الكلمة الطيبة. With this good word. Remind them. That's what Rabbi mentioned. It doesn't mean to begin to chant it. It means that someone from a distance may begin to make dhikr of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Remembers Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Don't compel, don't force a person to say the words. Recite them at a distance. The person begins to reflect. Remind them about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. وَذَكِّرُوا بِأَيَّامِ اللَّهِ. Indirectly remind them about the days of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So we find that once that kalima is mentioned, because we find that this kalima, this statement, outweighs everything upon this dunya. That some of us have always become externally what we want to look at. It is a great blessing. Whoever من مات على ذلك, whoever dies upon that. وَآخِرُ كَلَامِهِ لَا إِلَهِ إِلَّا اللَّهِ دَخَلَ الْجَنَّةِ. Whoever's final words, لا إِلَهِ إِلَّا اللَّهِ عَلَى ظَاهِرِهِ. Person who died, doesn't find نادراً. Very rarely do you find a person who's leaving this dunya. Very rarely do you find a person leaving this dunya, he said, لا إله إلا الله. Because this is an ultimate prize from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Whoever makes that kalima, makes that statement and leaves this dunya, pass away, then that individual دخل الجنة. That individual will enter into paradise. That is what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala judges that individual. That you find Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala described inside Surah Ibrahim, talking about the shajara. أَصْلُهَا ثَابِتٌ وَفَرْعُهَا فِي السَّمَاءِ. Its foundation is deep down in the ground, and its branches branch out to the sky. And every so often they give out the fruits and benefit the people. As we find the ulama mentioned, as Imam Sa'd inside his tafsir mentioned, الْكَلِمَةُ الطَّيِّبَةُ وَكَلِمَةُ الطَّيِّبَةُ. The true word, قَوْلُ ثَابِتٌ inside this ayah, is قَوْلُ لَا إِلَهِ إِلَّا اللَّهِ. That is a firm statement that we find. A person makes that inside their life, lives according to that. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will bless that individual. يُثَبِّتُ اللَّهُ الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا بِالْقَوْلِ الثَّابِتِ فِي الْحَيَاةِ الدُّنْيَا فِي الْآخِرَةِ. Will make ithbat of these individuals upon this dunya with that statement. Likewise, إِنَّ الَّذِينَ قَالُوا رَبُّنَا اللَّهُ ثُمَّ اسْتَقَامُوا. Those individuals say, our Lord is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, remain steadfast upon that. As you find in certain athar that you find, as Shaykh Abdul Wahhab in his works, Kitab al-Taqeed, has mentioned, that never commit shirk with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Whether you are shredded apart or whether you are burnt alive, the person is focused in their commitment, in their devotion, in only calling upon Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That you find, unfortunately, there have been Muslims leaving this dunya, that their final words have been what? Praising individuals, asking individuals, calling upon individuals. Hada ainu shirki is the essence of shirk, of dying in a state of calling upon other than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Calling upon so and so to rescue me, to save me, to help me, to send me across the bridge. To all this aid that we find that exists, unfortunately, for this Muslim ummah. It's all anwa with shirk with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It's all clear formats of shirk with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. No one can rescue, no one can save you, no one can cross the bridge for you. Wa hatta rasul. Even the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam cannot do anything for any individual, as ulama mentioned. Because here we find the Quran mentioned, innaka la tahdi man ahbabt, walakin Allah yahdi man yasha. You cannot guide the ones that you love. ليس عليك هداهم ولكن الله يهدي من يشاء. He's not upon you to guide. This is the Prophet عليه الصلاة والسلام. He had this natural love towards his uncle. The Quran rebukes him. إنك لا تهدي من أحببت. You cannot guide the ones that you love inside your life. You have to accept it. Inside your life, there's going to be individuals who don't respond to the call. This is Sunnah في القرآن. Sunnah of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala inside the Quran. And some people become emotional about this. Ibrahim عليه السلام, his father, Azar, he used to make the idols in the seer and these days of Hajj that we find. What was the end of this individual? His father would be brought in a way as a ram in front of him, as a hyena that we find presented in front of him. Nuh alayhi salam, his son doesn't believe. Innahu laysa min ahli. He says that Nuh alayhi salam mentioned, he's from my family members. Look at the istilahatul Quran. Look at the language of the Quran. Innahu laysa min ahli. Innahu amalun khayru salih. He's no longer your family member. Why is he no longer your family member? He's my blood. I'm his father. إِنَّهُ عَمَلٌ غَيْرُ صَالِحٌ خَلَاصٌ فَلَا نِقَاشْ لِذَلِكَ أَعْمَالُهُ غَيْرُ صَالِحًا. This individual, إِكَانَ وَلَدُكْ is your son, his actions are impious actions. He's no longer your son anymore, as far as the Sharia is concerned. Obviously, when a person believes in their family members, has iman, it becomes strength, nur ala nur. Musa alayhi salam, he prays for his brother Harun, make him to become a wazir like I'm a wazir. That strengthened him, both brothers, blood brothers, and believers in faith as well that we find. Lut alayhi salam, his wife does not believe. Does that mean that there's some blame upon the Anbiya? Hasha wa kalla. There's no blame upon them. She was full of treachery, khiyana, the treachery that we find that she was full of. That some people may try to understand this approach to Quran, that she done some form of immoral action. As a side point, none of the Anbiya and none of the family members have ever been tarnished with immorality. When the Quran talks about khiyana, talks about treachery, about deception, it's talking about them, talking about certain things about the messenger, saying about them, or doing certain actions, never committing anything out of wedlock, fornication or adultery. All the seerah of the Anbiya that we find, they're all selected and chosen by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Their family members may not have believed. No one individual can come and find the lineage of any of the Anbiya to begin to say something that they did something wrong. That's why even talking about Maryam alayhi salam, it raises the blame from her. That's why one reason that Isa alayhi salam spoke in the cradle that we find was to clear the blame from his mother. What they said about her, and when she mentioned even herself, يَا لَيْتَنِي مِتُّ قَبْلَ هَذَا وَكُنْتُ نَسْيَ مَنْسِيَّا. As a young woman who's never had any relationship inside her life, never seen any man inside her life, even Jibreel alayhi salam approached her, came in front of her as an individual. She said to him, go away. In kunta taqiyya, you're a pious individual, you should not be entering inside my private arena, entering inside here. This is a pious woman that we find, Maryam alayhi salam. But his blame that was placed upon her, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wanted to lift that blame away from her. That ayat came down, showing her purity. That's why Isa alayhi salam, he spoke that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made me good to my mother, and whatever it places attribute towards her. These are the anbiya, these are the chosen people of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that we find. They cannot guide whom they love. So the Prophet alayhi salam, he had this natural love towards Abu Talib. But that love was not able to become a form of guidance that we find. And that ayat was sent down, that you cannot seek forgiveness for such individuals. Likewise, other ulama mentioned these ayat, when we say that Surah Tawbah that we find, is talking about the parents of the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam. And here some people get very emotional and begin to attack people of Ahlul Sunnah. There are various aqwal in the ulama about the parents of the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam. There are certain minor statements that we find that they were Muslims. Other statements that we find that they were in a state of what's known as Hanafiya. In a state that there was no messenger that was sent or there's no revelation. So they should be taken as the messenger that came before them, Isa alayhi salam. So they should become neutral individuals. A third view that exists, that they'll be asked on the day of judgment to believe or to be jumped into the fire. And they jump into the fire and enter into paradise. The other view that exists, which is a large portion of you, Ahlul Sunnati wal Jama'ah, that the parents of the Prophet did not believe. And they both will be inside the hellfire. People should not get emotional about this. When we have discussed this in great detail that we find, hadith in such a Muslim that we find. A man asked, inquired about his father. Where is my father? فَعَجَابُ الرَّسُولُ قَالَ أَبُوكَ فِي النَّارِ. He said, your father is inside the fire. The man walked away with that natural love. Became difficult inside his heart to bear, difficult to bear. And you've just told me that my father is inside the fire. He called him back. He said, Inna abaka wa abi finna. He said, indeed, indeed, my father and your father are both inside the fire. They tried to make ta'wil out of these hadith and say only from emotional feeling the Prophet began to condone him or began to give condolence towards him to make him feel better. The Prophet would not say such words to make a person feel better, to say that your father, my father, both are inside the fire. Hadith is Sahih Muslim that we find. So people should not get emotional that we are trying to benefit his parents. Sunnah al-Quran is there. You cannot guide whom you love. You're not responsible for them. You can only encourage them. And that's why we find the Shafa'a. The intercession of the Prophet alayhi salam is plausible and exists for even these certain members. That's why Abu Talib. What is the least punishment given this individual? We find authentic narrations. Even though he done all this hard work to protect and to help the Prophet alayhi salam, he wear two shoes of fire that will make his boiling brain. This is the least amount of punishment. Tasawwaru hadha. Two shoes of fire he will wear that will make his brain boil. This is shafa'ah. intercession will be given لتخفيف له, to lessen his punishment. But even though we find there is no coming out of the fire for this individual, unfortunately, for this individual did not believe in the prophecy or the teachings of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam that we find. مَا كَانَ لِلْنَبِيِّ وَالَّذِينَ آمَنُوا أَنْ يَسْتَغْفِرُوا لِلْمُشْرِكِينَ. It's not befitting for the Prophet and those who believe to seek forgiveness of the mushrikeen. وَلَوْ كَانُوا قُلِي قُرْبَ مِنْ بَعْدِ مَا تَبَيَّلَهُمْ أَنَّمَ أَصْحَابُ الْجَحِيمِ. It's not befitting, even happen to be your family members, you seek forgiveness for them after it's been made clear to you that these individuals are amongst the people of the hellfire. And thus we find another lesson that can be learned from the life of Abu Talib that some of us fall short to understand about our relationship towards non-Muslims in general that we find. The Quran mentioned that يَنْهَاكُمُ اللَّهُ لِلَّذِينَ لَمْ يُقَاتِلُوكُمْ فِي الدِّينِ. Allah Ta'ala does not prevent you from showing goodness to those individuals who never ever fought against you and who never ever expelled you, وَلَمْ يُخْرِجُوكُمْ, never expelled you from your homes. أَنْ تَبَرُّوهُمْ وَتُقْسِطُوا إِلَيْهِمْ إِنَّ اللَّهَ يُحِبُّ الْمُقْسِطِينَ. You show goodness and kindness to those individuals. Islam does not prevent an individual from showing goodness to a non-Muslim, taking care of a non-Muslim, showing good etiquette and good behavior towards them. Islam does not prevent that. There's no harm in that. As we mentioned, Anwar al-Fukbi, types of love that we find, is natural for a person to help the human creation around them. And the ultimate help is to help them, to remind them about returning back to the path of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Thus we find that this natural love led the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam to take Ali, take him under his wing, just like his father Abu Talib took care of him. And the ulama seerah mentioned, because Abu Talib had many children, so as he became older, it became difficult for him to take care of each and every one of his children. So the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam, he returned back the gift of him taking care of him when he was younger, he was an orphan, and said, let Ali come into my house, and let me raise this individual, take this individual inside my house. أَنَا مَدِينَةُ الْعِلْمُ وَعَلِي بَابُهَا. Some individuals mentioned, even though hadith is plausible and questionable that we find, that I am the city of knowledge and Ali the gate to enter into it. The authenticity is highly questionable, but the meaning existed. The one way to come to the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam is via his family members, via them narrating what took place inside the home. Thus we find the most frequent narrations which talk about the household of the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam are narrated by Aisha radiallahu ta'ala anha, the second largest narrator of hadith that runs ulama of major hadith. Second largest narrator, many hadith that she talks about are about the private affair, the private life of the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam that we find. So his goodness and his kindness that we find at the age of 9 or 10, that's why ulama of seerah mentioned that he's the first individual to become a Muslim. And others clarify that the first boy, the first young free boy to become Muslim is Ali ibn Abi Talib. By him just visualizing the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam, he was the ultimate mentor, the best role model that we find. And some of the works of seerah that begin to write, when he began to see how the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam was offering his prayer and how Khadija was standing there and they both offered their prayers, that began to make him begin to think about what format of prayer that we should follow inside our lives. And the side point, some ulama mentioned that the format of the prayer for a man and a woman is identical. What we find in dissecting inside our society, some ulama fiqh have talked about a distinction between the man's prayer and woman's prayer. In general, we see from the ulama, we find there is no distinction between a man's prayer and a woman's prayer. Because صَلُّ كَمَا رَأَيْتُمُونِي أُصَلِّي. Hadith in Bukhari, pray as you have seen me pray. Follow the prayer of the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam. There is no clear wording where the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam said that a woman should place her hands like this, or she should offer her prayer like this, or she should make ruku like this, she should make sujood like this. The Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam made general statements. And tarka kada, touch together, you prostrate like this, you bow like this, you make dua like this, you stand like this. All of it is general that we find. If there is some specific wording, it becomes specific at that certain location, does not become something that a woman's prayer is totally different from a man's prayer. A man's prayer, a woman's prayer is identical to the prayer of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam that we find. Thus we find that this love, it developed. It developed to such a degree that Ali ibn Abi Talib, you read once again in Sirah, Ali was the one who rested inside the bed when the Prophet made the hijrah, made the exodus. He risked his own life and he would lie there. He would lie there all the time to gather together to execute and to kill the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam. He was one lying in the bed waiting. And they're going to kill him, they're going to kill him in place of the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam that we find. And that was Ali ibn Abi Talib that we find. His love, his devotion to such a degree, his most beloved daughter Fatima, he married her to Ali ibn Abi Talib that we find. Not mere lip service. Ali minni وأنا منه وهو مني. Ali is from me, I am from him, and he is from me. In the Surah Imam Tirmidhi that we find. Because we find whoever makes Ali angry has made me angry. And whoever Ali is the protector, I'm the protector of that individual. Some individuals try to go beyond the bounds and try to narrate fabricated narrations. An-nadhra ila wajhi Ali ibadah. To look at the face of Ali is a form of ibadah. Min al-mawdu'at, it's fabricated. No such thing that we find to look at. The face of Ali is a form of ibadah that we find. Ali, Imam Ali Khalifa that we find, is respected. عند العلماء أهل السنة عند المسلمين respected for his thoughts and his belief that we're going to touch upon this individual that we find. Likewise, we find he's given the title of his love and devotion, Abu Turab. His laqab, his title is given to him. You read the seerah, you find why his name was given to him. One day the Prophet ﷺ entered into the house and he assumed that something had taken place, and Fatima said that I argued with him and he left the house. This is his daughter. We mentioned many times the love and devotion towards her. And that was his son-in-law, that was his cousin. But look at the Prophet ﷺ in his justice, in the way he understood certain things, how to deal with family members. Did not go out and begin to blame Ali. How dare you argue with my daughter? How dare you get angry with her? How dare you say this to her? He said, he asked where is Ali. He said, he's in the masjid. So he walked over to him. And then he rubbed his back and said, Qum ya Aba Turab, stand up, O father Turab, because you're rolling around the dust. His title stuck with him. And the companion began to call him Abu Turab, the father of the dust. This is how the Prophet ﷺ, he dealt with the people around him. And that's when he entered into the house one day, because Fatima naturally began to say to Ali, go and ask my father. Go and tell him, express him, look at my hands. Kneading the dough, washing the clothing, taking care of the house. My hands have become rough. You know, some of the captives have been brought back. Some wealth has been brought back. Request him. They send a servant to help us inside their house. Hadha Rasul, walidu Fatima. This is the father of Fatima. Every one of us who is a father today, if our daughter requests us something, then I'm sure that all of us will fulfill that for our daughter. Hubban, ibn Atina, love for our daughters that we find. Look at the Prophet alayhi salam, how he teaches his family members. Fadakhala baynahuma, he entered amongst them and he sat between them. They could feel the warmth of the body of the Prophet alayhi salatu salam. They could feel it, the warmth that he had, a natural love. Because the Prophet alayhi salam is amongst the ultimate miracle set upon this earth that we find. The ultimate miracle upon this dunya. Everything about him is unique. Hatta that you find even his sweat. The sweat that we find is sweat of musk. That's the Prophet alayhi salatu salam. The special distinctions that are given to him. There's a natural warmth in his body that we find it exists there. They feel that warmth. And he says to them, both of them, don't think I'm unaware of what your request was. But I don't want my family members to be over-worried about these things of the dunya. Shall I not tell you something which is far better than having a servant and having what you requested me for, or asking me for? Every night when you go to sleep, say Subhanallah 33 times. Say Alhamdulillah 33 times. Say Allahu Akbar 34 times and recline and go to sleep. After Salah, we know it's 99 times, and then to say La ilaha illallah wahdahu la ilaha illallah hadith that we find. But going to sleep, say Subhanallah 33 times. Alhamdulillah 33 times. Allahu Akbar 34 times. And recline and go to sleep. Ali radiallahu anhu mentioned, I never left it in my life. Once he said that to me, وَحَتَّ فِي الْحُرُوبِ, even in warfare, when I was fighting in expeditions, I made sure every single night, I made this dhikr and then I reclined and went to sleep. This is far better for his family members, far better for our family members as well, to give them spirituality, to give them remembrance of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Because things of the dunya will come and go, but iman is something which is a treasure, which has no value. If you lose iman inside your heart, you lose iman with the people around you. No wealth can ever fulfill that return or that cavity to bring it back, your family members back. Likewise, you find the love and the journey continues. In the treaty of Hudaybiyah that we find, whereby you find that the individuals are refusing to write the Prophet's name, sallallahu alaihi wasallam, refusing to write his name with the message of Allah. Ali becomes emotional and begins to take the part for take it and begins to write his name. How dare you refuse to write me the messenger of Allah? And thus we find that many times he's been praised and given a certain rank in the Battle of Khaybar that we find in the 7th year Islamic calendar. The Prophet ﷺ mentioned that tomorrow I'm going to give the raya, the flag, to a person who loves Allah and his messenger. And Allah loves that individual as well. Umar al-Khattab, he mentioned, these are one of the rare occasions in my life, I aspire that in the morning, I'm going to be that individual. that some of the ulama of Syria, they mentioned that in the morning he began to strut, he began to walk in front of the Prophet alayhi salam, that choose me, here I am. You said it's going to be an individual who loves Allah and his messenger. He's going to be selected to hold the flag. But the Prophet alayhi salam, he asked, "Wayna Ali? Wayna Ali?" They said that he is suffering from an ailment inside his eyes. There's an ailment, almat fi aynihi. There's some disease inside his eyes. So the Prophet alayhi salam called him. He called him, فَبَصَقَ فِي عَيْنَيْهِ. The Prophet ﷺ, once again, another miracle. He spat saliva. His saliva is blessed inside his eyes, and he became cured instantly. Instantly became cured. And then he gave him the flag. And he told him to go out. And as he's walking out, the Prophet ﷺ told him to go out. فَصَرَخَ, he called out. أَنَا مَا أُخَاطِلُ النَّاسِ. What should I fight the people against? Fight them until they testify that none has the right to be worshipped except for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the Prophet, the Messenger of Allah. And if they testify to that, then need their accountability. فَحِسَابُهُمْ عَلَى اللَّهِ سُبْحَانَهُ وَتَعَالَى. Some of the ulama of hadith, they mention, they explain this hadith. أَصْلُ الْإِسْلَامِ وَدِينُ السِّنِّ. Essence of Islam is a deen of peace. Essence of Islam is not deen al-harb, but deen al-hurub. Essence of Islam is not a life of fighting, of warfare. That's the essence of Islam. The essence of Islam is calling people and tad'uhum ila al-Islam, to call them to Islam. That you find in other narrations that we find, even if one individual, talking to Ali, one individual responds to this call, khayru min humur al-na'am, is better than a red she-camel, which is the ulama of hadith mentioned, that the Quran and Sunnah at times it talks about, gives amthal, gives parables, which tuqarim al-Arab, which is something similar that the Arabs can begin to understand. The most prized commodity for these individuals was a red sheep camel. In today's language that you find, a red Ferrari or red Lamborghini has immense value. That's the value of one individual. You call them to Islam, that is a prized gift given that individual. The prized gift is not to harimum, but to qatilhum, to kill them, to slay them, to decapitate their heads that we find, to burn them, to torture them. لا أصل في ذلك في الإسلام. There's no essence of that inside Islam that we find. إلا نادرا. Only in rare occasions are the seerah. The Prophet ﷺ may mention that execute this individual, bring this individual. نادرا. Very rarely that we find. وهؤلاء معروف. Those individuals were known for their harm, for the difficulties that we find. And so the natural sharia of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala we find, and Islam that we find, دين الأمن, is a life of peace, tranquility. Unlike what some individuals, all aqidah in essence, they are minute view of individuals that we find. Those are individuals who are classified as kharijites, min al-khawari. Those are the individuals, الذين يؤمنون بتقتيل المؤمنين, تقتيل المسلمين. Those who believe in killing of Muslims, leave aside killing of non-Muslims, is not allowed until there's certain parameters. But go beyond that. Say that it's allowed. جائز لنا نقتل المسلمين. To kill Muslims, or ولاة الأمر, people in authority, people in power, people who govern, anybody who works for the government, works underneath them. الشخص الذي يشتغل للحكومة, فما إثمه? Person who works inside the government, what's his sin? What's the sin for a person who may open the door of a building? Open a door, a car door, for a person who works, a minister who works inside a building. What's the sin of that individual? تحاربه, تقتله, kill him, slay him, execute him. Because by default he's an enemy. لا أصل في ذلك في الشريعة الله سبحانه وتعالى. No essence at all inside the Sharia of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to do that, or for any individual to allow that. No individual should believe that. And no individual should teach that inside society. And Islam is based upon teachings that exist from the beginning to the end. That the Prophet alayhi salam, he taught his people, he taught his comrades, taught the individuals around him. And that's what Ali ibn Abi Talib became. An individual who became just inside his life. Because that's something else that we Muslims have forgotten. A concept of justice that we find. In his time with the Khalifa that we find, his armor, as many ulama seerah mentioned, his armor went missing. Machine was very much missing. It came in the hands of a Jewish individual. Ali ibn Abi Talib, he recognized his armor. He wears it all the time. He says to the individual, return my property back to me. The Jewish individual says, there's no proof it's your property. There's no proof that you can bring. Bring the dayina, bayina, bring the evidence this belongs to you. So he came with his servant. He came with his servant. And the Jewish individual says that you know inside your sharia, you cannot bring your own family members or people who work for you to give a testimony for you. You can't use that. So they raised it to the Qadi, to the judge. Qadi at time is Qadi al-Shuraih, is a judge at that time. So the judge listens to the case, and he hands over the sheen to the Jewish individual. Hands it over to him. The Jewish individual, obviously, he wants to see something about us Muslims that some of us have forgotten today, of deen al-adl, of deen of justice. You are the Khalifa. You're the person in power. You govern and you rule. He's your judge. It's your rule. Your authority. It's your servant. It's your armor. Belongs to you. You can take it by force and say it belongs to you and present the evidence in front of you. This is what deen al-Islam is. A deen of justice. A deen of equity, some of us have forgotten. Never ever send your soul for a bowl of rice, for some worldly profit. Muslim is just to be every single individual around him. Every single individual. لا يغشو أحد. Never cheats any individual. من غشنا فليس منا. Whoever cheats us is not from amongst us. In this hadith that we find the Prophet is walking in a marketplace. A person has got their crop, got their barley, got their wheat presented beautifully in front. He thrusts his blessed hand inside and he feels that it's wet. The person is covering up their property. وَيْلٌ لِلْمُطَفِّفِينَ. Those people who cheat in individuals. When they weigh, then they weigh short for their own benefit. And when they weigh for something for them, they weigh less for the other individual. Prophet entrained the Sharia talks about it openly. What we find in today's society, that some people have begin to cheat. That's what some of us Muslims are. When it's our benefit, then the Sharia becomes crooked. When it's against us, once again the Sharia becomes crooked. The Sharia should be straight. The Sharia should be like a sword for every single individual. Every single individual comes underneath that sword. If it's something that belongs to you, you take it. If it doesn't belong to you, you leave it. Don't twist the laws of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to justify your own ends. Thus you find the end does not justify the means. It is haram to steal, to lie, to cheat, to rob, and then to say that this is benefit for Muslim Ummah. Even if we find among some individuals in our society, they steal, they say this is Darul Harb, a land of warfare. So we steal from the disbelieving individuals and then we give the wealth to the Mujahideen. Billahi alaykum. Al-Mujahideen are pure individuals. They're pure individuals. They don't need haram wealth. They don't need haram wealth people to steal. Because we find, unfortunately, I hate to say these words, there are some Muslims who racketeer in drugs. And they say that the wealth goes to the Muslim cause. What Muslim cause? What Muslim cause is there? Al-haram? La yufid illa al-muharramat. Haram only justifies opening up doors for haram. Islam does not need haram. It doesn't need you to rob from people, to steal from people and say that it's going to a good cause. The cause of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is pure wealth. That's why even the Quraysh understood that. When they built the Kaaba, they said to the people around them, make sure not even one dinar, one dirham has been polluted with the wealth of riba. هَعُلَيْ مُشْرِكِينَ مُشْرِكُونَ بِاللَّهِ سُبْحَانَهُ وَتَعَالَى disbelieving, polytheists. So when you construct this house of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, وَلَا دِنَارْ وَاحِدْ, not even one dirsh, make sure one coin is not contaminated with riba. Not one coin we build this house of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. نَحْنُ وَالْيَوْمْ مَا نَحْتَمْ. Today we don't care where the wealth come from. Is it halal or haram that we find? Give it to the masjid. Let the masjid should ask. If a person's wealth is known that this person deeds in haram, nothing can purify your wealth. You can't run an off license. You can't sell haram. You can't do haram things and say, this is where I purify my wealth. Things which are clear-cut haram, as we find, إِنَّ اللَّهِ إِذَا حَرَّمَ شَيْءٍ حَرَّمَ ثَمَنُهُ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala makes something haram, its wealth, its commodity becomes haram. كُلُّ haram. لَا نِقَاشْ بِذَلِكَ. Everything is haram. People say, living in نَعِيشْ الْغَرْبِ نُبِيعَ الْخَمَرِ نُبِيعَ tobacco. We sell tobacco, we sell wine, we sell alcohol. لَا نَشْرَبُهُ. We don't drink it. We sell it to al-kafra, we sell it to non-Muslims around us. مَنْ أَجَازَ ذَلِكَ. Who allowed that? None of the fuqaha. The only aqwal that you find, the only statement that you find is some of the fuqaha in the Hanafiya, and even the authenticity has to be verified. I've talked about a person is living right outside the parameters of a Muslim land, and some people may begin to sell and buy some form of wine product, they know, be sold as wine, grapes, whatever. Some of the fuqaha, well, ilm with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala about authenticity, because we don't want to blame the ulama in the Hanafiya that we find. There's some people clinging to this, that they've mentioned this, so this makes it plausible and halal for us to buy and sell alcohol. There is no scope inside the Sharia of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to buy and sell alcohol. That's why in the hadith of Sahih Muslim that we find, 10 individuals are cursed, everything that's linked to Khamr that we find is cursed. And that is what a Muslim should be, a Muslim who preaches the deen of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to benefit the people and to teach the people. There's nothing to hide in that Sharia. Because we find another reason, always making excuses. That the Sharia does. Yes, Sharia is crystal clear. There is jihad, fi sabilillah. Why not beat about the bush? Why should we pretend that there is no jihad? There is jihad inside the Quran and the Sunnah. It exists there. But obviously there's hudud, there's parameters, there's teachings how we conduct it. So don't wash away the subject. Teach non-Muslim. You will see that more non-Muslim will be receptive when you teach them the truth. That this is what Sharia said. There's a death penalty that exists inside the Sharia. Why should we hide away from it? This country, until 1965, the last man to be executed, to be sent to death row, in 1965 inside this country, in America to this day, amongst the 52 states in the United States of America, many of them still adopt what's known as death row, the death penalty. Person is brought to the execution chair. Person is brought to death, or person is ejected to death, or electrocuted to death, or person is court-martialed to death. That exists in the Western world. So what's that mean? What is the blame upon us Muslims that we shy away from it? What's the blame upon us Muslims that exists inside their land? Amputation that we find? The Sharia talks about it. If a person goes beyond the parameters, steals or does something wrong, there's amputation, there's hudud, there's punishments that exist there for fornication, for adultery, they exist there. The only difference is, these laws do not exist inside this environment. That's all. And so the existence of the Sharia, they remain there until we find that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala liberated Muslim Ummah, bring it back once again to governing and ruling and judging by the commandments and the laws of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. وَقُولُ قَوْلِ هَذَا وَاسْتَغْفِرُ اللَّهِ لِي وَلَكُمْ وَلِجَمِيعِ الْمُسْلِمِينَ فَاسْتَغْفِرُوا إِنَّهُ الْغَفُورُ الرَّحِيمُ. Mm-hmm.